NASA has seen the innards of Jupiter's Great Red Spot for the first time. It is impossible to ignore the sizable red mark when seeing Jupiter. The largest and fiercest storm ever recorded on the giant planet in our solar system. Scientists have not determined how long it rages on Jupiter, but Robert Hooke first viewed it with a telescope in 1664. Several teams have explored Jupiter's massive storm throughout the years. From Earth, spacecraft including Voyager 1, Voyager 2, and Cassini investigated the planet during their brief flybys. The Big Red Spot was found by the Hubble Space Telescope. Recent Hubble data indicate that the spot is shrinking. Initially, the storm engulfed three Earth-sized planets. In addition, the storm has intensified over the past decade and can now contain a world slightly larger than Earth. From 2008 and 2020, according to Hubble data, the wind speeds near the enormous red spot increased by 8%. The shape of the anticyclone has also changed. It is challenging to gain detailed observations of the Great Red Spot from Earth in an oval or circular configuration. Even the most advanced terrestrial and alien telescopes can only detect a part of this storm. We must instead travel to Jupiter and undertake ongoing observations. Specifically, this is what the Juno spacecraft has been performing. Juno, launched in 2011, arrived at Jupiter 5 years later. It has been researching Jupiter's magnetosphere, cloud tops, radiation belts, and moon composition while orbiting the planet. However, Jupiter's fatal radiation makes it extremely difficult for the Juno mission to approach the planet. But, after 5 years of exploration, Juno has found what lurks beneath the dense clouds of Jupiter, notably in the vast red patch. As it turns out, Jupiter's enormous red spot is significantly more extensive and penetrates the planet far more deeply than anyone thought. According to data from the NASA Juno probe, the massive storm reaches 510 kilometers below Jupiter's cloud tops. Isn't that profound? That is the same height as the International Space Station above the surface of the Earth. If a storm of this magnitude occurred on Earth, the ES would be 500 kilometers above us. This intriguing topic is how scientists assessed the red spot's depth and what they observed there. Questioning is necessary for comprehension. Two study teams produced these results. First, a group determined the mass of the enormous red spots. They sought to determine if the gravity of the storm affected Jupiter. The concept was basic. The 16,000-kilometer-wide storm was targeted by Juno's gravity research equipment to see if it left an imprint on Jupiter's gravitational field. This evaluation was unique from the initial plan for Juno. On the other hand, analyzing a plane's atmosphere by studying gravity is a previously introduced notion. Several NASA spacecraft have accomplished the same feat on Earth. In addition, gravitational devices can view further into the atmosphere than other equipment. That was the first time the enormous red spot had been noticed this way. Unfortunately, the undertaking proved hazardous. The scientists were still determining whether they would discover anything noteworthy. The enormous red zone is a mere speck compared to Jupiter's total mass. Nonetheless, enough fluctuations in Jupiter's gravitational field were detected to estimate the storm's intensity, 500 kilometers. In addition, jets with a maximum range of 3,000 kilometers fueled the enormous storm. As the first crew measured gravity at the spot, the second team examined the battery using the microwave radiometer aboard Juno. This instrument employs microwaves to investigate the atmosphere of the planet. These scientists desired to observe the vertical progression of the storm from within. They discovered that Jupiter's sizable red spot and similar storms extend to unprecedented depths and that participation in the draft has reached unprecedented levels. Also, they found evidence of similar processes below Jupiter's cloud level, where ammonia and water are expected to congregate. Gravitational and microwave data suggest that Jupiter's upper atmosphere is somehow connected to these depths. The enormous red area on Jupiter is a roaring anticyclone. Many cyclones and anticyclones on Earth are comparable. Nevertheless, new research indicates that hurricanes are warmer at the top where air concentrations are lower, and more uncommon at the bottom where air concentrations are higher. Conversely, anticyclones rotate in the opposite direction, and are calmer at the top and warmer at the bottom. In addition to its cyclones and anticyclones, Jupiter is distinguished by its belts, zones, and white and reddish bands of clouds that wrap around the planet. Solid breezes moving in different directions from east to west separate the bars. Winds or jet streams with depths of around 3,200 kilometers were observed by Juno. Researchers continue to investigate the formation of jet streams. Ammonia gas in the atmosphere flows up and down in a manner well linked with observable jet streams, according to data obtained by Juno's instruments throughout many flights. Since 2016, the Juno spacecraft has been continually researching Jupiter. As a result, the mission was granted a 5-year extension in 2021. If all goes according to plan, Jupiter's orbit will adjust to take it over the planet's north pole and away from its most prominent red spot in the south. The Juno probe can observe Jupiter's mystery polar cyclones and 4 Galilean moons. There are mysteries of the early solar system on Jupiter. Exploration of the planet is necessary to comprehend the solar system's creation. Eris, the mysterious forgotten planet. On February 28, 2004, Michael Brown announced the discovery of Sedna, an object with a radius of more than 2,000 kilometers. When it was observed orbiting between the Kuiper Belt and the deepest area of the Oort cloud, it appeared that the solar system had discovered its 10th planet. But the excitement of the moment was short-lived. The circumference of Sedna, while intriguing, was swiftly reduced. Hence, there is the same number of planets as before. After only 517 days, Mike Brown detected another huge object on July 29, 2005. Its diameter was 2,400 kilometers greater than Pluto's, proving that it met all requirements to become the 10th planet in the solar system. But Pluto's orbit exceeded the initial one. The result was eventually revealed. After it became known, Eris was never regarded as a planet, and Pluto likewise lost its classification as a planet. Consequently, the number of planets decreased from 9 to 8 rather than increasing. Nevertheless, even after he was demoted, Pluto's name remained popular. On the other hand, Eris was practically forgotten after missing the train that would have brought it fame, presumably because it was assumed to be one of several planet toys that would continue to be discovered in the Kuiper Belt. The forecast needed to be more accurate. In remote places, nothing remotely comparable has been discovered since 2005. Eris remains the 9th most massive object in the solar system, and its discovery was the most significant since the 1847 discovery of Triton, Neptune's great moon. The Oort cloud is the optimal location to search for anything more substantial. Even there, we may discover something less deserving of the name planet. So far, as we can determine, Eris needs significantly more attention than it has received. Using automated search techniques, they examined all taken images. Eris was discovered on January 5, 2005, using photographs taken on October 21, 2003, by astronomers Michael Brown, Chad Trullio, and David Rabinowitz. What's taking so long? Why hadn't they observed it earlier? There's a straightforward answer to this. They had spent years scouring the sky and had identified several gigantic trans-Neptunian objects, such as quasar, Orcus, and Sedna. As a result, object detection was greatly accelerated, and a more significant portion of the sky could be scanned. So, the software will leave out anything that moves faster than 1.5 arcseconds per hour. Their distance estimates differ. Consider this in deciding how modest this modification is. The Moon's angular diameter is 1800 arcseconds. Then we discovered Sedna, an item that moves extremely slowly. The software failed to recognize the presence of Brown and his co-workers. Throughout the preceding months, the acquired images were re-examined and re-analyzed. Thus, this was the only way they could locate the object that would eventually become Eris. The trans-Neptunian migrated more slowly than the background stars. Therefore, it was disregarded during the early analysis phase. The discovery was made public 2 days after Sunday service on July 29, 2005, the same day as Mars. Further observations yielded a preliminary orbit with inaccuracies. The Hawaii 10-meter telescope detected the presence of a Dysnomia satellite on September 10, 2005. Dysnomia is the second largest moon of a minor planet after Pluto's Charon, with a diameter of approximately 700 kilometers. At 37,000 kilometers per hour, it orbits Eris for around 16 days. Brown was carrying a massive thing alongside a massive moon. Pluto's discovery also marked the beginning of its demise, as it looked like Eris would eventually usurp Pluto's position as the 10th planet. In 2006, Pluto and Eris were designated as dwarf planets, a classification that currently includes Ceres, Haumea, and Mark, rendering the orbit very eccentric and inclined. Eris's orbit around the Sun is exceptionally eccentric and takes 559 years. Perihelion is 38 degrees around the Sun, whereas aphelion is 98 degrees away from it. One cycle takes 25.9 hours to complete. Eris's perihelion occurred in 1699, and her apogee occurred in 1977. Perihelion will occur on December 22, 2057. If you don't count long-period comets, Eris is the most distant thing in our solar system. Unlike the orbits of the other eight planets, Earth's orbit around Eris is roughly 44 degrees tilted. This is why, despite its high luminosity, it was observed in 2003. Most celestial bodies are located on the ecliptic plane where most searches for big outer solar system objects are conducted. 524 AU was the semi-major axis of our meeting with the detached object Sedna when we discussed things beyond Neptune. At 84 AU, it is approaching the Sun. Depending on its inclination, its perihelion will occur in 2075 or 2076. Eris is now in Cetus, passing only a handful of zodiacal constellations. Since its discovery, Eris has gradually decreased in diameter. According to 2003 Hubble Space Telescope images, Eris had a diameter of 2,397 kilometers. On this occasion, the standard Eris's albedo and apparent brightness method was utilized. Astronomers use the term albedo to describe the reflectivity of a celestial body's surface. Maximum albedo occurs when a substance reflects all incident light. Albedo equals zero if no light is reflected. The first illustration is a perfectly white object. In comparison, a totally black object, Eris, has a higher albedo of 0.96 than Enceladus, the sixth largest moon of Saturn. Ice on its surface is assumed to cause its excellent reflectivity. Eris now orbits the Sun from a tremendous distance away. Eris, whose diameter is 2,370 kilometers, is more prominent than Pluto in the best-case scenario. Pluto and Eris are significant objects, but it is difficult to determine which is more significant. By interfering with observations of Pluto's solid surface, Pluto's atmosphere further complicates matters. In 2007, the Spitzer Space Telescope determined that the dwarf planet's diameter is 2,600 kilometers. In 2010, an occultation of a heavenly body occurred. Such a distant object has never been observed occulting in our solar system. The outcomes were especially detrimental to Spitzer Space Telescope's measurements. The occultation of Eris provided a diameter of only 2,326 kilometers, as calculated by the stars. The New Horizons mission determined Pluto's diameter to be 2,376 kilometers in 2015. Pluto is currently the most massive dwarf planet, although only by a small margin compared to Eris. Furthermore, the consideration of mass is required. It is impossible to precisely determine the mass of an isolated object like Eris. The discovery of dysnomia has led to the discovery of a solution to the problem. Using Kepler's third rule and the orbital period and distance of a satellite from its parent planet, it is possible to quickly calculate the mass of the parent planet. Based on a simple calculation, Eris's density must be higher than Pluto's, given that Eris's mass is 27% greater than Pluto's. Based on the diameter calculated during the stellar occultation, Eris has a 2.5 grams per cubic centimeter density, significantly greater than Pluto's 1.75 grams per cubic centimeter. Eris and Pluto appear identical in size, but they are not. Our planet has an average density of 5.5, whereas water has a density of 1. Thus, it is reasonable to assume that their compositions varied. Pluto is composed of denser and more rocky material than Eris. Some experts think approximately 70% of the globe is composed of rock, and 30% of the planet is composed of ice. Depending on the distance from the Sun, temperatures on the surface and in the atmosphere range from minus 240 to minus 216 degrees Celsius. Unfortunately, there is no direct way to observe the Earth's surface features from the ground or orbit. Thus, indirect measurements, such as spectrum analysis, are necessary to gain a deeper understanding. The Gemini North Telescope in Hawaii recorded spectra on January 25, 2005. Analysis of the infrared spectrum was utilized to find methane at the surface. Carbon monoxide and nitrogen were also identified as being abundant. This is analogous to Pluto. When Eris approaches perihelion, sublimation mechanisms will be initiated, releasing gases from the surface and creating a thin atmosphere. Once Eris leaves its perihelion, aphelia's surface temperature will steadily decrease. Air gases can re-sublimate, freeze, and return to the surface as temperatures drop. Methane may sublimate at these temperatures due to its high volatility. Nonetheless, another query arises. How can methane be so prevalent if it is so flammable and volatile? There are two potential outcomes. First, Eris has always existed so far from the Sun that sublimation has never been feasible. Internal replenishment of methane is another possibility. Second, Eris's surface needs to be adequately examined. Again, observation alone is an option for us. Like most other objects investigated in Kuiper Belt future research, Eris is grey. It also has a different hue than Pluto and Triton, both reddish. Due to its great distance and small size, studying Eris necessitates the employment of advanced telescopes and technology. Seeing Eris with the soon-to-be-operational James Webb Space Telescope is a possibility that may arise soon. Eris was considered one of several follow-up missions to research the Kuiper Belt in the 2010s. If launched on April the 3rd, 2032 or April the 7th, 2044 using Jupiter's gravity assist, a flyby mission to Eris would require 25 years. To our knowledge, Eris will be 90 to 92 AU from the Sun when the spacecraft arrives, but this is speculation. We will continue to dream about Eris for a considerable amount of time. How James Webb, in a couple of months, revolutionized cosmology. In 1995, Robert Williams, an astronomer, proposed targeting the Hubble Space Telescope to a region of the sky that had nothing notable for 100 hours. His co-workers reprimanded him because they believed it was an awful plan that would waste necessary telescope observation time. As director of the Space Telescope Science Institute, he was allotted 10% of the observation time. Hence, the complaint was rendered moot. He may utilize it for any purpose. Williams claimed that he would quit if the probe uncovered nothing suspicious. From the 18th to the 28th of December, Hubble spent 100 hours observing a small portion of the sky near the handle of the Great Dipper, roughly 1/30th the breadth of the full moon. The telescope captured 342 photos of the site, with each exposure lasting between 25 and 45 minutes. The sky's vast void was filled with galaxies. Nearly 3,000 individuals arrived, releasing 12 billion years. All galaxies' colors are red, blue, orange, and yellow, including spirals, ellipticals, and lenticular ears. The sights disrupted the universe in ways that scientists could not have anticipated. This image is currently referred to as the Hubble Deep Field. Despite the beautiful quality of the Hubble Deep Field, researchers desire more. After more than 3 decades, this prospect became a reality with the $10 billion James Webb Space Telescope. Midway through 2022, Cycle 1 of Webb's first year of scientific observations commenced. Two of its Cycle 1 activities spent hundreds of hours observing different sections of the sky to locate distant galaxies from the early universe. Astronomers did not anticipate anything extraordinary. They expected that the two short-term activities of Cycle 1 would polish the Hubble Deep Field. To their surprise, these galaxies were apparent immediately. Astronomers initiated the discovery of galaxies that must have existed inside the first 200 million years after the Big Bang. The scientists were ecstatic because Webb had unintentionally uncovered the final significant, previously unknown epoch in the universe's history. But these galaxies were unlike what we had anticipated. They were instead dazzling, with a stellar mass of billions of solar masses. Such mature, enormous galaxies defy our present picture of the universe's evolution. What went wrong with our models, then? How can we explain the James Webb Space Telescope's latest extragalactic observations? Do these discoveries specifically support the Big Bang theory? Consider the moment when the cosmos was believed to have been created in the first second to solve the puzzle. After the Great Bang, all four known fundamental forces separated. The universe was a soup of primordial particles that was both hot and dense. As the universe expanded and cooled during the next 3 minutes, helium nuclei and other extremely light elements began forming. Continue for 400 million years. The universe was chilly enough for the formation of the initial atoms. After around 150 million years, the first stars began to form, ending the Dark Ages. These vast stars, known as Population 3 stars, were primarily composed of hydrogen and helium and lacked the heavier elements in current stars. They were responsible for producing the first proto-galaxies and the gas clusters that adhered to enormous, invisible dark matter formations. These proto-galaxies united because of gravity to create large galaxies. This complex procedure has lasted for billions of years. Yet, Webb's findings cast doubt on this entire hypothesis. Scientists believe monumental protogalactic fragments that have not yet merged to form a giant galaxy exist. A couple of the objects they are observing are already giant galaxies. With a redshift of 13.1, GLZ 13.1 is one of them. In astronomy, redshift is represented as a dimensionless number. Hence, Z equals 0 illustrates the present, and its value for deep space objects increases, so do their distance and our look-back time. The discovery of galaxies with redshifts larger than 11 is essential. Yet, after 30 years of research, Hubble could only locate one. Conversely, Webb is an infrared observatory that can view regions of the universe that Hubble cannot. According to Redshift, SWGLUC-13 existed during the first 300 million years of the universe. The initial redshift measurements were photometric, obtained by observing the galaxy via various colored filters instead of spectroscopic analysis. Consequently, since photometric redshift is more precise, astronomers sensed a problem with the redshift value. Nevertheless, additional observations from Chile's Atacama Large Millimeter Array, or ALMA, suggested that this candidate was an exception. The redshift of the object is roughly 13. GLZ-13 is as massive as a billion suns, which contradicts our understanding of how stars arise. This is because even if you used every available resource to construct stars, you would still need to achieve that size early on. And if star formation was rapid and efficient, why do we not observe it in galaxies today? With the traditional cosmological model, it is difficult to explain these facts. Lambda symbolizes dark energy in the lambda CDM paradigm, while CM represents cold dark matter. Astronomers are incorporating Webb's observations into many cosmological models. Lambda CDM model proponents claim that producing prominent stars in the early cosmos may have been highly efficient. This is because severe temperatures and gas pressure substantially impact star formation. Magnetic fields emerged sooner than believed initially and had a crucial role in propelling material to commence star formation. Another simple explanation is that the galaxies in the early cosmos had little or no dust, which made them look brighter. The online discoveries may also corroborate the controversial idea of modified Newtonian dynamics, or MOND, proposed in 1983. MOND argues that large-scale gravitational oscillations can explain the influence of non-existent dark matter. In contrast to the Lambda CM model, MOND can provide several facts as supported by Webb's early observations. Even if hundreds of galaxies discovered by the James Webb Space Telescope do not meet existing cosmological models, this does not contradict the Big Bang theory. This is because it was developed over the past century utilizing countless visible data that cannot be disregarded. For instance, the Big Bang accurately predicts the amount of each element formed in the early universe. As astronomers view ancient galaxies and stars, they detect remains of the past. The observed quantities of each chemical component are compatible with the Big Bang theory. In addition, the redshift of distant galaxies is consistent with the Big Bang idea. It now takes longer for light from distant galaxies to reach Earth. That is redder than it ought to be. This redshift is caused by the movement of galaxies away from us. Observations indicate that all objects in the cosmos are receding from one another. If you could travel through time, you would witness galaxies clashing. The Big Bang theory predicts that if you could travel back in time far enough, everything in the universe would have existed in a single location. The most persuasive evidence is the cosmic microwave background, first postulated in 1948 and discovered using the Big Bang theory in 1965. The first web-based extragalactic programs indicated that current theories of star formation and galaxy evolution must be revised. By examining a more significant section of the sky over extended periods, the projected Cosmos Web Initiative is anticipated to significantly increase the number of early galaxies. Scientists expect discovering hundreds of such galaxies, which will assist in refining our database and developing more accurate models. Within 120 million years of the Big Bang, some simulations indicate that Webb may detect a redshift of 26. If proven correct, it would represent a turning point in astronomy. Enceladus has astounded NASA's scientists. Enceladus is a satellite. The solar system's most fascinating object, the Moon is just the sixth biggest moon of Saturn. Under natural illumination, it appears unremarkable. Yet, Enceladus has much more than meets the eye. This icy globe's southern hemisphere is covered in water vapor jets. Due to Cassini's fantastic mission, we have researched and observed Enceladus in detail, and we may know more about it than some of the larger and closer Jovian moons. Even though we have observed a great deal from the exterior, the moon's interior still holds many surprises. We will learn virtually everything about Enceladus by stitching together photos and data from many missions. Let's embark on this journey together. To understand Enceladus's position in our solar system, we must determine where it fits. Currently, 14 moons orbit Saturn closer than Enceladus. A few moonlets exist within Saturn's rings, which may or not be considered moons in the future. Mimas is the only moon that orbits closer to it. Its orbit brings it barely beyond Saturn's ring system. It orbits Saturn every 33 hours, following the ring planes precisely. Dione, the fourth most giant moon of Saturn, is in resonance with it on a 21 orbital level. It orbits Saturn twice in the time required for a single orbit. The orbit of Enceladus will never be perfectly round due to the orbital resonance that causes tidal deformation. As a result of these tidal forces, Enceladus's core is heated. Saturn is so far from the Sun that, as far as we can tell, the outer layer of water on Enceladus has frozen over, and this frozen layer is composed primarily of pure water. Enceladus is a frozen ocean world devoid of any other substances. With an albedo of 0.81, the Moon is one of the whitest objects in the solar system. It is one of Saturn's coldest satellites, with a temperature of minus 200 degrees Celsius at noon. The planet's pristine surface reflects a significant part of the sunlight that strikes it. However, pressure begins to increase roughly 30 to 40 kilometers below Enceladus's surface, and the heat energy created by Enceladus's tidal deformation has raised the temperature of the water ice to a degree where liquid water may exist at this depth. In the same way, a magma mantle supports our rocky crust, and an ocean or entire water mantle may support the ice crust. At the very least, the Moon's south pole is predicted to contain a large water reservoir. What proof do you have for this claim? Cryovolcanism is the emission of vast plumes of water from fissures in the crust. These jets propel around 250 kilograms of water per second into space at speeds surpassing 2,000 kilometers per hour. Particles of water vapor can resist most of this force. Enceladus orbits Saturn due to its low gravity, producing Saturn's E-ring. If the Sun is backlighting Saturn, the surrounding ring will be visible. Light beaming through water particles creates a strikingly blue ring when viewed from this angle. Due to its uniformity, this ring is the bluest object in the solar system, much more so than Neptune. The width of the second outermost ring, which holds the earring, is roughly 2,000 kilometers. The orbit of Enceladus also influences its shape. As fresh material erupts, Enceladus's plumes create ring-shaped tendrils. As Enceladus moves away from Cassini, the ring sections tend to smooth out. By traveling through these plumes, Cassini could detect the substances they produced. Cassini was not designed for this purpose. As Cassini arrived, the plumes were immediately identifiable. Cassini was additionally equipped with the Cosmic Dust Analyzer, which detects dust particles in Saturn's orbit. Even though the technology was not explicitly designed for Enceladus's plumes, it could manage them. These particles may provide a fuzzy representation of their contents. The most abundant component was water, but amino acids, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and methane were also detected. It should be emphasized that amino acids, the building blocks of life, can be found near heat vents on the ocean floor. Do thermal heat vents exist on Enceladus? If so, could there be a live ecosystem around them? Although Enceladus has a subsurface ocean, its inner structure remains a mystery to scientists. Enceladus was once believed to be permeable to water. According to Cassini data, Enceladus's mass may be larger than previously thought, suggesting that its core contains iron or silicate. According to certain researchers, the internal structure is differentiated, indicating that it is a layered celestial body. This size item does not require differentiation. It is either in hydrostatic equilibrium or rounded by gravity due to its diminutive size of approximately 500 kilometers across. For instance, Neptune's Proteus is not in hydrostatic equilibrium with objects of comparable size or smaller. Even with a differentiated interior, it is likely to be primarily rocky. Enceladus's oceanic thermal vents must originate from a rocky core. A rocky ocean floor would support life as we know it and provides minerals and fertilizers. The presence of amino acids in Enceladus's plumes and their thermal activity serve as evidence. Cassini charted Enceladus's thermal emissions as it passed over the Moon. The jets correlate with the tiger stripes of Enceladus, also known as tiger stripes. These depressions are enormous, with dimensions of over 130 kilometers long, 2 kilometers wide, and 500 meters deep. These features may be the result of tectonic fissures on the Moon. The lack of impact craters in the planet's southern hemisphere and other places is one of the most surprising features of Enceladus's surface. Since the plume-ejected water makes up the atmosphere of Enceladus's sea surface, it is argued that the planet is relatively young. This number of asteroids cannot be consumed before their impact on Earth. Thus, water from the plumes returns to the surface and gradually smooths it out. Enceladus has a round shape due to its size. Except for a few craters and tectonic fractures, Enceladus's terrain is highly homogeneous. Rugged terrain is all around the South Pole. There are both smooth and jagged portions at the North Pole. One location contains fewer craters than the other. There are no plumes on this side of the Moon, despite tectonic cracks. The older surface appears more constructed than the surface surrounding the South Pole. Cassini traverses a gas plume that soared above the South Pole. In addition, the camera got close-up images of the surface's tiger stripes. This surface is very stunning. There is nothing else comparable on Earth. This unique fracture line and formation on the ice's surface result from surface folding, compression, and shifting. Cassini's accomplishment in approaching Enceladus so closely was remarkable. Unbelievably, we can see something so far but so close. Unfortunately, since the conclusion of the Cassini mission, Enceladus can no longer be investigated. Several mission concepts were cancelled before implementation. An Enceladus ocean probe, or one that investigates the plumes for signs of life, would be incredible. With the Dragonfly mission, visiting Titan's neighboring moon is feasible. Yet, this situation has nothing to do with Enceladus. A few mission plans to go there have been evaluated, but we will have to wait at least a few decades, which is unfortunate, because we need to know what is beneath the surface. Hubble recently demonstrated that the current physics we use needs to be revised. It was discovered in the universe on January 1, 1925. According to Edwin Hubble's research, the Milky Way was not the only galaxy in the cosmos at the time. This discovery allowed the universe to expand and eventually the Big Bang to occur. Nonetheless, while studying distant galaxies, Hubble discovered a pattern. He found a relationship between a galaxy's distance and its recessional velocity. This means that a galaxy moves away from us faster than it moves away from us. This rule is referred to as Hubble's law. Despite its simplicity, this relationship contains one of the universe's most essential secrets. The sum of the two sides of the Hubble constant yields the total. But why do cosmologists believe this constant is so crucial? What insights can we glean from measuring it precisely? Finally, what new Hubble Space Telescope observations have revealed the need to update our understanding of the universe? Academics have attempted to limit the value of the Hubble constant over the years. Instead of dispelling uncertainty, the discoveries increased it, resulting in a cosmic crisis. But first, let us try to understand the physical significance of the Hubble constant. The Hubble constant shows that a galaxy's recessional velocity is proportional to its distance from Earth. If the recessional velocity is expressed in kilometers per second and the distance between the universe and our galaxy is expressed in megaparsecs, the Hubble constant has units of kilometers per second per megaparsec. If the Hubble constant was 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec, the speed of a galaxy away from us, h, would increase by 70 kilometers per second for every megaparsec of distance. In cosmology, the Hubble constant is also an important parameter. It can be used to delve deep into our universe's history from the Big Bang to its conclusion. Why is it so difficult to calculate the Hubble constant precisely when the physical nature of H is so apparent? What is the source of its difficult-to-calculate reputation? The answer lies in the criteria used to assess them. First, the Hubble constant was observed and measured. There must be figures. A galaxy's recessional velocity and distance can be calculated using the object's cosmic red shift, measured by the wavelength variations of the spectral lines it emits. Even with this, the second factor, distance, may pose more significant difficulties. A common technique for calculating distance is to observe Cepheid fluctuations within a galaxy. Like all variable stars, SIF has gone through a brightness cycle, going from brightest to most brilliant again. A Cepheid's brightness is directly and inversely related to its irregular period. The brighter the Cepheid, the longer the fluctuation period lasts. The Cepheids were studied by astronomers who compared their apparent and intrinsic brightness. By measuring the difference between observed and absolute brightness, the distance modulus equation can calculate their distance. Edwin Hubble was the first to use variable stars to calculate distance, and Cepheid variables serve as standard candles. The period-luminosity relationship must be calibrated first using nearby independent variables whose distance can be calculated using the parallax method. The cosmic distance ladder refers to computing cosmic distances in stages. The problem is that the level of uncertainty grows with each level. Edwin Hubble was able to map the variations in distance and recessional velocity for 46 galaxies, yielding a Hubble constant value of 500 km per second per megaparsec, which is approximately 7 times what scientists now believe. Cepheids, on the other hand, have a range of measurement of 50 megaparsecs and 1 kiloparsec. What about distances that are longer than this one? The behavior of galaxies within 50 megaparsecs cannot be used to determine the value of a constant. We need to travel further to make more precise calculations, which is where type 1a supernovae come into play. When a white dwarf consumes its partner, it enters uncontrolled fusion and explodes as a type 1a supernova. Because supernova explosions are so spectacular, they are used to calculate longer distances. The Hubble SHU program, which stands for supernova H, rather than the equation of the dark energy state, has greatly aided in measuring the universe's expansion rate using these supernovae. The SHU team estimated the Hubble constant in 2019 to be around 74 kiloparsecs per second per megaparsec. The SHU project looks at galaxies less than 2 billion light-years away to determine the universe's current expansion rate. To make sure that this total is correct, we must go back in time to validate it using theoretical predictions. And if we can figure out how fast the universe expanded after the Big Bang, we can use that figure to calculate the Hubble constant. They were doing this while a disaster was unfolding in front of them. As a result, we know that a massive amount of energy was produced during the superheating of the cosmos following the Big Bang. Radiation became increasingly redshifted as the universe expanded. The CMB, or cosmic microwave background, governs the amount of redshifted radiation. The CMB, or irregular electromagnetic radiation, was left behind by the early universe's creation. Instead, it is divided into hotter and colder zones to represent the uneven distribution of matter and energy in the early universe. Fundamental physics had to be combined with estimates of the mass and energy present to model the universe's expansion from the beginning to the present. Based on the accuracy of multiple methodologies, the best measurement converges on a value between 67 and 68 kilometers per second per megaparsec. This obviously contradicts the findings of the data. According to mathematical simulations, the universe will likely expand more slowly than Hubble's discoveries predicted. This is currently one of the most pressing issues in cosmology. Researchers have recently made strides in improving the accuracy of their observational values. The SHU team looked at 42 supernovae milepost markers that exploded at a rate of about 1 per year, accounting for over 1,000 Hubble orbits. This analysis of every supernova the Hubble Space Telescope observed is nearly complete. According to their calculations, the Hubble constant is 73 kilometers per second per megaparsec, plus or minus 1 kilometer per second. This discovery outperforms the theoretical prediction of 67.5 kilometers per second per megaparsec, plus or minus 0.5 kilometers per megaparsec. However, the measurement is approximately 8 times more precise than Hubble predicted. Given the massive Hubble sample size used this time, there is a 1 in a million chance that the current estimate will need to be updated. Even though the cause of the disparity between predicted and observed Hubble constant values are still unknown, the new findings are expected to pave the way for discovering new physics. Astronomers estimate the size of the universe by looking for recent events and objects. Two examples are red giant star mergers and neutron star mergers. Furthermore, once NASA's Webb Space Telescope is fully operational, we can anticipate higher resolution and more precise observations in the future. NASA discovers astonishing facts about Jupiter's largest moon. Ganymede, the third Galilean moon of Jupiter, is home to the largest ocean in the solar system. Nevertheless, something else differentiates Ganymede from everything else we have witnessed. Under the surface of this Jovian monster is a perplexing riddle. We will explore this odd event and investigate the moon's other features. Ganymede is the third Galilean moon and one of Jupiter's four most prominent satellites. There are three other Galilean moons besides Io, Europa, and Callisto. The diameter of Ganymede is the largest of the four, measuring 5,268 kilometers. It is 1.02 times larger than the most massive moon, Titan, previously postulated, and 0.41 times larger than the diameter of the Earth. Due to the dense atmosphere that reaches hundreds of kilometers into space, it was initially more visible. Although having less mass than Mercury, Ganymede's volume is 26% bigger. Mercury has a 5.4 grams per cubic centimeter density, but Ganymede has a 1.9 grams per cubic centimeter. It has the same composition as Europa. Ganymede's surface is covered with a 150 kilometer thick layer of ice that extends beneath an ocean of liquid water. It is truly remarkable in terms of size. The quantity of water on Ganymede reduces Mercury's average density, which has very little water but is rich in dense metals. Ganymede's ocean contains more water than all of Earth's oceans and seas combined, and it is expected to reach a depth of 100 kilometers, which is 10 times deeper than the deepest point of our ocean. Ganymede is 50% water, with the balance consisting of ice, metals, and a trace of rock. Ganymede stems from Greek mythology, in which Zeus, or Jupiter, as the Romans knew him, appointed a young man named Ganymede as the god's cupbearer. Jupiter might also transfer water around Ganymede. Oxygen abounds in Ganymede's atmosphere. If Ganymede is rich in water and has an oxygen-rich atmosphere, might life exist there? Unquestionably, it is doable. Due to Ganymede, this is only partially definite due to unique properties. The oxygen atmosphere is fragile to begin with. It is expected to be between 0.2 and 1.2 microparticles, or 100 billion to 500 billion times less than Earth's atmospheric sea level pressure. If this were true, breathing would be difficult. In addition, whereas ecosystems have existed in the ocean's depths without sunlight on Earth, a massive barrier on Ganymede may prevent this. Given how deep Ganymede's ocean is, it is likely that pressure alone would force water to turn back into ice. Geothermal vents send out materials that make it possible for life to live in the deepest parts of the ocean. Because Ganymede has a significant layer of ice between its core and the ocean, this is implausible. Hence, Europa, Ganymede's neighboring moon, is believed to be more likely to support life. Yet, if Ganymede's ocean is salty, Ganymede's interior makeup could be significantly transformed and become increasingly evident. Several ice layers may split a salty ocean, according to models. The internal layer of the planet would encounter the planet's rocky core, thereby increasing the likelihood of life. There is water and ice beneath Ganymede's surface. Another extraordinary event for which science has no explanation, Ganymede in some manner generates a magnetic field. Scientists discovered Ganymede's magnetic field in 1996 after a series of flybys of the frozen moon. Auroras were observed despite Ganymede's cloudy atmosphere, proving the planet's magnetic field. As Hubble saw over time, a salty ocean beneath Ganymede likely created magnetic friction, causing the auroras to not oscillate as anticipated. The Earth's magnetic field is essential because it protects the planet from the sun's radiation. This lets life grow and thrive. Yet Ganymede is not entirely protected from such radiation by the barrier that encircles it. It continues to be bombarded by Jupiter's massive magnetic field and radiation belt. A human would become gravely ill or die if exposed to 5 to 8 rems on Ganymede's surface for 2 months. Even so, it surpasses its nearest neighbor, the moons. For this magnetic field to exist, there must be a credible explanation. We inhabit a planet with a hot, molten center. The surrounding magnetic field is produced by convection currents transporting electrons within it. This is not what Ganymede should be experiencing. Given Ganymede's size and composition, scientists feel the core should have solidified into a solid mass rather than remaining liquid. There would be no magnetic field, and convection would prevent electrons from moving. Some moons of Jupiter do not possess magnetic fields. Ganymede is the only planet in our solar system to possess a single moon. Why does this occur? Tidal heating and Ganymede's close connection with its planet and neighboring moons may help to explain this mystery. Due to its eccentric orbit, Ganymede completes a round of Jupiter in about 7 days. Sometimes in its orbit, Jupiter is closer to Earth than at others. When an object is subjected to a powerful gravitational force, its mass will expand in the direction of gravity. Once an object moves further from the source of gravity, it will return to its former shape. Ganymede has an eccentric orbit around Jupiter. When subjected to varying amounts of gravity, it constantly expands and contracts. How frequently have you reshaped a ball of blue tack by stretching it in your hands? You may have noticed an unexpected rise in temperature after a while. Friction is produced during stretching as the material brushes against and on the scale of planets and moons. As a result of the friction, there is a build-up. When tidal forces generate frictional heat, tidal heating occurs. Ganymede has also caused a Laplace resonance with Io and Europa, an exciting process. Ganymede orbits Jupiter exactly twice, Europa precisely 4 times, and Io exactly 5 times. Due to the moon's mutual gravitational attraction, the system has tried to maintain momentum. This suggests that Ganymede experiences constant pressure from its neighbor's gravity. This may explain why Ganymede's surface is so attractive. Scientists are still determining, though. 1/3 of Ganymede's surface is comprised of dark areas, while the remaining 2/3 is made up of brighter regions. According to scientists, the greater frequency of impact craters in the darker areas suggests that they are older than the lighter areas. Although the lighter parts contain fewer craters, they feature thousands of kilometers of lengthy ridges and grooves. Due to tidal heating, Ganymede's core could remain liquid, allowing it to continue producing a magnetic field. This is an incredible sight to see. The origin of these ridges is uncertain. During times of instability in Ganymede's past, tidal forces may have caused the planet's surface to expand. This tidal force may have also preserved the magnetic field of Ganymede. Scientists have gained insight into Ganymede's composition by analyzing the regions where auroras appear in the moon's atmosphere. Scientists could only confirm the existence of subsurface water if they set foot on Ganymede. The juice could aid in solving the other mysteries of Ganymede. The explorer of the ice moon of Jupiter will discover the answers. The ESA spacecraft will launch in 2022, but will not reach the orbit of Ganymede for another decade. The spacecraft will then explore the inner workings of many of Jupiter's moons, including Ganymede. We may have to leave the mysteries of Ganymede unexplained while we wait for their solutions. But, unfortunately, this is the only mystery element. Seeing other planets and moons in the solar system can significantly enhance our understanding of how life evolved on Earth. For instance, we can compare species in neighboring solar systems with those in the Jovian system, which consists of 4 enormous moons. Actual pictures of Saturn. What Cassini really sees. This image, captured by a camera on Saturn, depicts the Earth as a tiny blue dot. In 2013, the Cassini mission obtained this iconic image known as the Day the Earth Smiled. Cassini spent 20 years in space, traveling over 8 billion kilometers and making 294 orbits of Saturn to study Saturn's icy moons and ring region. Cassini-Huygens was a mission laden with danger. Jupiter and Saturn are gas giants that hold the solutions to the mysteries of the early solar system. and sending a spaceship to explore these planets is an artistic endeavor. Saturn has been visited by 4 spacecraft, but only Cassini has orbited the planet. The remainder were mere flybys. In contrast, the space probe's voyage was exhilarating. Now, tighten your seatbelts as I take you on Cassini's spectacular trip to Saturn. On October 15, 1997, the sparkling exhaust of a Titan 4B rocket carrying the Cassini probe illuminated the sky over Florida. Cassini was not the only passenger on board, though. Instead, it was accompanied by the European Huygens probe, the first artificial object to settle on a planet outside the solar system. Cassini-Huygens was among the giant interstellar spacecraft ever constructed. However, the space capsule's overall launch mass of 5,000 kilograms made reaching Saturn in a single shot challenging. Due to this, the enormous spaceship had to utilize gravity assistance more than once to accelerate. On his approach to Saturn, Cassini passed by several additional planets. 6 months after its launch, on April 25, 1998, Cassini successfully performed a flyby of Venus. These flybys gave the spacecraft sufficient speed to traverse the asteroid belt. Once Venus passed, the Sun's gravity pulled the spaceship back into the inner solar system, allowing it to rejoin its home planet. About 2 years after its launch, Cassini finally conducted a gravity-assisted flyby of Earth. Due to the quantity of radioactive fuel on board, the interaction was hazardous. During this flyby, Cassini took photographs of the Earth and Moon to calibrate its cameras. This enabled the spacecraft to escape the Sun's pull and continue its mission. Cassini was hence the 6th spacecraft to traverse the asteroid belt. The closest approach of Cassini to Jupiter took place on December 30, 2000. During the 6-month flyby, almost 26,000 photos of the gas giant, its weak rings, and its moons were captured. Moreover, Cassini took one of the most detailed global color images of Jupiter. In addition, this was the very first photograph taken by the mission. Moreover, Cassini captured a stunning image of the planet's active volcano moon, Io, with Jupiter in the backdrop. After a successful flyby, Cassini departed Jupiter for its last destination, Saturn. Yet, it was a challenging path riddled with obstacles and testing. The confirmation of Einstein's theory of general relativity was one of the highlights of this tour. In 2003, mission researchers investigated how the Sun deflected and received radio signals from Earth to Cassini. In addition, they calculated the effect of the Earth's and spaceship's velocities on the round-trip time. In conclusion, Cassini's findings firmly confirmed Einstein's general theory of relativity and contributed to an increase in precision to approximately 1 part in 51,000. Cassini completed its final approach to Saturn in February 2004, launching the League of Extraordinary Observations of Saturn's system after a few more months of travel. On June 11, 2004, the Cassini-Huygens probe identified 7 new moons around Saturn. Ultimately, Phoebe and Cassini traversed the orbit of the moon. The probe snapped brilliantly shining regions of Phoebe's badly cratered surface. The photos revealed an abundance of subsurface ice. Cassini entered Saturn's orbit on July 1, 2004, following a 7-year trip. Cassini became the first spacecraft to orbit Saturn in May of this year. Cassini performed its first flyby of Saturn's giant moon 1 day after Titan's orbital entrance. During this period, the probe captured multiple images of Titan's lakes. On December 25, 2004, Cassini launched the Huygens mission to examine Titan. On January 14, 2005, the Huygens spacecraft entered the atmosphere of Titan. After a 2.5-hour descent, the plane landed on firm ground. Once Huygens landed, Titan's immense methane oceans were exposed. This discovery marked the first time lakes were found on a planet other than Earth. Titan has therefore been added to the list of potentially inhabited worlds as a viable option. Although scientists are still attempting to determine the source of Titan's vast amounts of methane, Titan's oceans may harbor life. Huygens was expected to spend several hours collecting data in Titan's atmosphere and potentially on the planet's surface. Instead, it communicated data approximately 90 minutes after landing. But we have yet to get a signal. Titan marked the conclusion of Huygens' mission, while Cassini continued to study Saturn and its moons. Cassini was attracted to the ice-coated moon of the solar system. The icy moon's south pole exploded with ice geysers, and the probe detected a disruption in Ancelotti's magnetic field. Several flybys of the moon by the probe indicate the presence of a salty ocean in contact with the moon's rocky interior. Exploring the enchiladas, Cassini discovered oxygen on Dione and hydrocarbons on Hyperion. The expedition also determined that the black regions on Iapetus's surface were caused by solar heating, so solving a 300-year-old lunar riddle. Years of research by Cassini have revealed that Saturn's rings are not smooth but somewhat textured. The rings look to contain gravitational waves resulting from the perturbations of the planet. The data obtained by the spacecraft assisted in identifying a potential source for Saturn's mysterious G ring. Moreover, it demonstrated that the rings of Saturn were entirely composed of water. There are tiny moonlets among the ice crystals. Watching the behavior of planet rings aids scientists in their understanding of planet formation. Saturn features some of the solar system's most intense storms. How, therefore, could Cassini have overlooked them? On October 25, 2012, Cassini observed the remnants of Saturn's 30-year superstorm, the Large White Spot. It was the first time a spacecraft circling Saturn's ring planet watched a storm. The storm caused ethylene gas levels on Saturn to increase by 100 times what was previously thought conceivable. In 2013, Cassini captured the highest resolution images of Saturn's six-sided storm, providing a view inside its fascinating hexagon. The probe also discovered evidence that the polar areas of the planet have their own seasons. The South Pole chilled about 17 degrees Celsius during the spring, while the North Pole warmed by approximately 2.2 degrees. Cassini was initially intended to last 7 years, but its lifespan has been extended multiple times. Cassini obtained funding for a mission extension of 27 months on April 15, 2008, followed by another extension in September 2010. Finally, in 2017, Cassini ran out of fuel, ushering in the grand finale. Cassini's most dangerous mission consisted of 22 dives across Saturn's ringless void. Cassini eventually collided with Saturn's atmosphere on September 15, 2017, in his previous orbit, disintegrating and becoming a part of the planet. In this bittersweet conclusion, data from Cassini was received for 30 seconds longer than anticipated, and the spacecraft was determined to have died 45 seconds later than expected. This technique was implemented by scientists and engineers to prevent biological contamination of any of Saturn's moons, believed to contain potentially viable ecosystems. Cassini's epic mission, which spanned nearly 2 decades, concluded with the grand finale, putting an age of exploration to a close.